I know myself, and you've known me longer than anyone else. Such knowledge is too wonderful. Understand it. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. I can't even comprehend it, but I know you see. The depths where I could make my bed, but I never went hide and seek. You're so good at finding me, only lost in the mystery of the depth of your love. Your hand will hold me still, even where my world is shaking. Your hand will hold me still. I'm fearfully and
good morning, church family. Let's everyone make their way to the sanctuary. Stand to your feet so we can begin praise and worship.
I believe in the sun. I believe in the risen one. I believe I overcome by the power. Amen. I'm alive because
was covered in sin and shame. I heard mercy call my name. He rode the sun away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because he lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, every fear is gone. I know he holds my life, my future in his hands.
Amen.
A shout of praise in this house. Y'all can go ahead and be seated so we can check out this week's announcements. Thank you.
Yo, what's going on, church? Good morning, good morning, good morning. It's so good to see you. Man, I love that song, Because He Lives. How amazing is that? Don't we need reminded of that every day? Like sometimes I think we can just celebrate that fact on Easter Sunday. Hey, he is risen. Amen. He's risen indeed. But sometimes we need to be reminded daily that because Jesus is alive, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. I can overcome the things that I'm faced with today. And I believe it's not an accident that you are here this morning. And we believe God's going to speak and he's going to move in our midst. We're inviting the Holy Spirit to just permeate this atmosphere this morning, because I believe lives are going to be changed. And my prayer is this, that none of us would leave this place the same way that we came in. But because of an encounter that we had with the one true living God, we would be renewed. We would be transformed. We would become more like Jesus. Church, I love you guys so much. My name is Pastor Michael. If I haven't had a chance to meet you yet, I want you to know you are welcome here. You are loved and your life has value. If it's your first time here, there's a connect card in the seat back in front of you. We just want to ask you to take a minute, fill that out, drop it in the giving box, hand it to a serve team member. That's just our way to connect with you and to get some information from you so then we can continue to connect with you throughout the week. Hey church, I don't know if you know this or not, but we launched our fall semester of small groups last week, and there is still time for you to get in, for you to join a group. We've got groups happening Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Sunday. So hey, there's a lot of options to get involved, to grow deeper in community. We've even got a group that's meeting on Zoom. If you don't think you can make it to somebody's house or here to the church for group, y'all let Gina Pike or myself know if you're interested in getting in a group and you haven't got connected yet. We want to make sure you get in one, because we believe here at our church that life change happens in the context of community. Sunday mornings are amazing, but there's an even greater opportunity to dive deeper into God's word, to fellowship together, and to grow together in a small group. So we want to encourage you to be a part of those. We've got our youth ministry, 7 youth happening Wednesday nights. It's been awesome, y'all. I'm just saying, I love our students, the now generation, and I want to invite you, all 6th through 12th grade students, to come hang out with us. Doors open at 6:30. Service starts at 7 o'clock. It's going to be an awesome time. Well, I think that's it for announcements. I do want to bring our attention to giving like I do every week, because here at our church, we believe that it is so foundational and important that we as followers of Jesus, that we obey God and His command to tithe. And so the tithe is our first 10%. So if you want to give through our church, remember, you don't give to our church. You give through our church to give back to God what was already His to begin with. You can do so by cash or check. The giving box is in the hallway. There's giving envelopes in the seat back in front of you. Or the way I give, and the easiest way, I think, is to get online to 7imchurch.com/giving. You can make a one-time gift, or you can set up your recurring tithe on there as well. And it just comes out automatically. Just a way to say, hey, God, I'm trusting you. Not just financially, but with every area of my life. And so I want to take a minute, and as we close announcements, pray over the tithe and offering as they come into the house this morning. So church, if you would you pray with me? Father God, we thank you. God, we pray over the tithe and offering as they come into this house. Father, we invite you to manifest and multiply these gifts given so we can continue to make your vision a reality, to make heaven more crowded, and to see all people experience the fullness of life in Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you that because of your blessings to us, we are able to now go be a blessing to others. And God, I pray that you would favor and bless the giver, that you would return to them tenfold what they give, and that you would open the floodgates of heaven as you promise in your word in Malachi 3:10 over their life as they trust you and as they bring the tithe into the storehouse. We love you, Jesus. Would you go before us today? Holy Spirit, have your will, have your way right here on earth, just as in heaven. We pray this in your precious and holy name, and all of God's children said, come on, church, amen, amen, amen. Why don't you guys stand to your feet? Hug your neighbors if you love them. High five them if you don't. We're going to continue to worship the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. His name is Jesus. Welcome home.
fall, prison shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Chains will fall, prison shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Captivity captive, Build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. We're your church, build your church, sing it, build your church,
sing it up,
build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. Your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. It's your church, build your church, build your church, build it from the ground up. Build your church.
Matthew 16:18-19, it says, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Jesus, Father God, we thank you. We love you, God. From the young to the old, we say yes, Father God. Use every single one of us to build your church. In this hour, Father God, I lift up Israel. I lift up your people, God. I lift up your leaders. Cover your children, Father. In this hour, do what only you can do, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Morning. How's everyone doing? Good, good. Man, y'all look good. Y'all look a little better than the 9 a.m. service because you had more time to do your hair and makeup. So just saying, y'all are more pleasant to look at. Man, it's good to be here. I love this church. I love this house. God's doing some amazing things. We are in week two of this series that we started last week called The Gates of Hell Will Not Prevail. And last week we talked that if we were going to be a powerful church, we were going to be a church that sees walls fall. And can I tell you, Jesus moved last week. People received his word. I got texts and phone calls throughout the week. Pastor, I'm knocking down walls. And I actually got so many of them, I thought I had to start asking, are you sure you're knocking the right ones down? Like, just making sure, like, nobody went home and said, honey, this wall, we got to, no, just kidding. But this week, I want to dive in. I want to preach. Is that all right? Can I preach this morning? Are y'all excited if I preach? Because I got a word that's been stirring in my heart. And if you're taking notes this morning, I'll give you the title in a minute. But if you're ready to receive the word God has for you, just say, I am ready. I am ready. Oh, man, we ready. Come on, somebody. The title of this morning's message is Spider Killers. Spider Killers. Now, it's spooky season. I know what y'all are saying. And I almost bought a bunch of spiders and let them loose in here just to prove my point. But y'all know there's some churches known for playing with snakes. I didn't want to be known for the church that plays with spiders, just saying. So I left those out. But I believe if we're going to be a powerful church, if we're going to be the church that Jesus spoke about when he said the gates of hell will not prevail against it, we're going to need to be a church full of spider killers. I was talking to a pastor friend of mine the other day, and he was telling me this story of a man he had in his congregation who came to him and said, preacher, I need you to pray for me. And the preacher said, yeah, we got a lot we could pray about. He said, no, preacher, I got a specific prayer. Can you pray that the Lord would remove the cobwebs in my life? I got a lot of them, and I'm just sick of living with them. And I don't know if any of y'all have ever lived in an old house before, but living with cobwebs is not fun. And so he said, preacher, I need you to remove these cobwebs. But he wasn't talking about natural cobwebs. He was talking about supernatural cobwebs. And so the preacher said, all right, we'll pray. So they prayed and he left. And next Sunday he came back. Hey, preacher, can you pray a little longer this time? Can you pray a little harder this time? Like, I'm just saying, y'all think us pastors, like, we don't pray hard the first time. So you got to tell us, hey, pray harder this time. Because those cobwebs are still there. I need the Lord to remove the cobwebs. And this went on for about 3 months. Every single Sunday, the man would show up. Hey, pastor, hey, preacher, can you pray? They're still there. Hey, can you pray? They're still there. And he kept going. And the preacher actually got annoyed. And he finally, on one Sunday, he drove to church. And on his way to church, he said, Lord, give me a word for this man. Because I just want him to shut up. And so he was praying. And the Lord spoke a word to him. And service was over, and rather than waiting for the man come to him, the preacher sought the man. He said, hey, brother, I got a word for you. I was praying this morning. Here's the good news, man. The Lord's been hearing your prayers. And today he said, really? Because them cobwebs are still there. He said, he's been hearing you. But I got bad news too. We've been praying the wrong thing. He kind of looked at the preacher like, what do you mean praying the wrong thing? The pastor said, here's the word. God said, stop cleaning cobwebs and go kill the spider. We've been praying for these cobwebs to disappear, but until you kill the source of the cobwebs, they're always going to be there. So we need to go kill the spider. And I don't know about you, but sometimes as followers of Jesus, we get in these routines where we end up spending so much time cleaning up the cobwebs. Y'all know what I'm saying. You were arguing with your kids outside before you came into church. We gonna clean these cobwebs so we can tell everybody at church that we're blessed and highly favored and our family's perfect. Oh, that's nobody else? Okay, just me. I'm the only sinner in the room. But we clean cobwebs. We get busy. And I've heard it said this way. If the devil can't defeat you, he's going to distract you. How? He distracts you by cleaning cobwebs rather than focusing on killing the spider. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 2:11, let us not be outwitted by Satan because we are not ignorant of his plans or of his designs. And so I believe this word is a word for the church that we're going to reveal Satan's playbook this morning, and we're going to attack it, we're going to destroy it, we're going to defeat it, and we're going to kill some spiders. Any of y'all have faith to be a spider killer in here this morning? Come on, say amen. Amen. I said, y'all got faith to believe you're a spider killer? Say amen. Amen. All right, come on, I'm killing some spiders. But first, if we're going to kill the spider, we have to identify it. We've got to begin by identifying the spider. The Apostle Paul said this in Romans chapter 7, verse 15. For I do not understand my own actions. For I do not what I want, but I do the very thing I hate. Now, if I do what I do not want, I agree with the law that it is good. So now it is no longer I who do it, but catch this, but the sin that dwells within me. For I know that nothing good dwells in me that is in my flesh. For I have the desire to do what is right, but not the ability to carry it out. For I do not do the good I want, but the evil I do not want is what I keep doing. Now if I do what I do not want, it is no longer I who do it, hear this again, but the sin that dwells in me. I read that and honestly, I'm like, I do, I don't, what is he saying here? Here's what it boils down to. The Apostle Paul's wrestling with a question. Why do I do what I don't want to do? Well, I have the desire to do good. I have the desire to pray for those who persecute me. I have the desire to be more generous with my time, talent, treasure. I have the desire to do all of the right things. I have the desire to love the unlovable, to reach the unreached. But why do I not do what I desire to do? And he says it's the sin living in me. It's my sin that's keeping me from being able to do what I want. I would put it this way. We often fall into doing what we do not want to do because we have a spider on the loose. As followers of Jesus, we often fall into doing the things we don't want to do because we've got a spider on the loose. We fall back into that addiction. Most people would probably say they never wanted to be addicted to the alcohol or the drugs in the first place. But there's a spider on the loose, so they fall back into doing what they do not want to do. Not only do we have to identify the spider, but we've got to be willing to admit there's a battle happening, and it's not a battle of the natural. We've got to understand there is a supernatural battle that is taking place. And for some people, there's two kind of ends of the spectrum we typically fall on. We've got the people that are totally ignorant to the supernatural and just act like life is defined by what they see. They aren't willing to admit that the demonic realm is real. They aren't willing to admit that we can actually pray and angels can intercede on our behalf. They're not willing to admit the supernatural, or they're all the way over here and they're so caught up in all of this spiritual that they're missing what God is doing right in front of their very eyes. And they're reading every conspiracy theorist in the world, and they were convinced that last Wednesday at 1:30 in the afternoon when all of our phones went off, anyone who got the COVID vaccine would become a zombie. Y'all know what I'm saying, right? But we've got these two, and we can't hide from the fact that the battle's happening. Why? Because you're never going to win a battle if you first don't admit that it exists. You can't overcome something that you're not willing to exist is there. And I didn't even say this first service, but for some reason I'm saying it this service. I absolutely hate Halloween. I'm going to go out there and say it. Our church is not doing a trunk or treat this year. We're not doing anything. But here's the thought that I have. We can't overcome something we're willing to entertain. So why are we going to entertain the demonic? Why are we going to entertain fear when that is the very thing that we've been charged to stand against? I'm going to let you and your family lead with your personal conviction. Do I think there's anything wrong with little Jim Bob dressing up as a cowboy on Halloween? Absolutely not. But how far are we going to let it go? What we're willing to entertain, don't be surprised when it takes a hold of us. We've got to overcome those things. It's time we stop entertaining them. I don't know who that was for. I didn't say that first service. But we've got to admit that there's a battle. We've got to identify the spider. So I know some of y'all are saying, Pastor, what's the spider? Because I know you're not talking about black widows, brown recluse, or tarantulas. So what exactly is a spider? Well, here's the difference between a spider and a cobweb. A spider is an agreement that you have made with a lie. I told y'all we weren't going to be outwitted by Satan. Can I tell you something? This is the same attack Satan has used from the very beginning. In the Garden of Eden, what happened? He approached Eve. Eve said, God said this. Here's what Satan said. Did he really say that? He deceived her with a lie. The problem in our fallen world today is Satan is still active. He is still there, and he's still deceiving people. Those spiders are agreements that we've made with a lie. Well, what's a spider look like for some of us? I don't know what your spiders are. We're going to get there. But here's what a spider could be. It could be this lie that you've come in an agreement with that your life is worthless. And so you try to find value in relationships. You try to find value in friendships. You try to find value in the bottle. And so you do these things because they give you value and they medicate the lie and bring you comfort in the midst of your lie. That's what a cobweb is. A cobweb is the medicator that brings false comfort for that lie. So here's what I want to say. If you came to me and you said, Pastor, I've got an alcohol problem. Can we fix it? Say, all right, let's get it fixed. But can I tell you something? There's a deeper problem than just the alcohol. We send people to AA. We get them in these rehabs. We get them in these programs. And that's why I believe that AA or whatever other system we try to use is only 60% effective is because it spends about 100% of its time addressing the symptom rather than the sickness. And I'm just saying, if I put out a medication for you because you were sick and all it did was clear up your symptoms but didn't address the sickness, there's going to be a time when the symptoms come back. And so we get clean and we're sober for 6 months, a year, 2 years, 3 years, and then we relapse. Why? Because we never addressed the spider. We just cleaned its cobweb. And it's not just alcohol, it's not just drugs. We do this in a lot of areas of our life. Pride, I've had people say, Pastor, I think I've got a pride problem. Well, you've got a pride symptom. The sickness is you've believed a lie, that your value is found in what other people say about you or the accomplishments you make on this earth. That's the spider. Let's address the root. Let's kill the spider. And guess what? When we kill the spider, the cobwebs tend to take care of themselves. So how do we identify these spiders? I believe it takes two things. The first is this. We've got to ask God. We can't get through this life on our own. For anybody that thinks they can, I don't know how you believe that lie. But we've got to ask God to reveal to us what our spiders are. What are the lies that we've come into agreement with in our own lives? And here's the truth, church. Many of you would probably say, I've asked God, but I still don't know what they are. Well, maybe you've asked God, but have you actually taken the time to listen? Or is your life so loud and busy that you can't actually hear when God speaks? Because sometimes the volume of our life can be so loud that when God is trying to speak to us, we can't hear it. The enemy can't defeat you. Guess what he's going to do? He's going to distract you. And oftentimes we fill our schedules with work, with pleasure, with activities, with DIY projects, with all of these other things, because we know the minute that we get just a moment of silence, God begins to speak, and some of us, we don't think we're ready for it. And so we distract ourselves, but we've got to turn down the volume of our life in order to hear God's voice. He's always speaking. I believe that. I believe he's always speaking. The question is, we're not always listening. So how do we change it? I had a thought. I shared this with First Service. I don't even remember who all was there a few weeks ago, but I've been praying. I really had a moment with the Lord a few Sundays ago because I preached a message and then we went into a moment of prayer. And I didn't dismiss service. And I was in the back and we were laying hands on people and we were praying for people. I just want y'all to know people were delivered, bodies were healed, things were happening.
And yet a bunch of y'all got up and left. And then I got up to end service and there was like eight of us here. And I started to look back and I watched service again. And so I started to notice 4 minutes into prayer is when people started to get up and leave. And I just felt like the Lord say, Michael, if my people can't spend 4 minutes in my presence on earth, then they're going to hate heaven. That is, if you're even going there. And I just felt this spirit of conviction in my heart, church, that we need to learn to get quiet and still in the presence of the Lord. But we've got a society and a culture that is constantly turning up the noise and turning up the to-do list and turning up the I'm just saying, y'all, I've never lived in a town this small. And I've never met this many busy people in my life. Why? Because if your kid's in middle school or high school, here's what it is. In the fall, they're on the football team. In the winter, they're on the basketball team. In the spring, they're on the golf, baseball, or track team. There's no off season. Because if they're something, they're everything. What if as parents, we decided to say, I'm going to set some boundaries in my kid's life. I'm going to stop letting the school system take advantage of them. And there's going to be some blank space for God to speak into their life. I've got students that can't even come to youth group on a Wednesday night because their coaches practice. This is why I believe revival is going to come through our students, because they're going to begin to stand up and go, I ain't about that. Jesus is number one or he ain't anything in my life. Jesus is Lord of all or he ain't Lord at all. I believe, and I think John was telling me this too, that we're going to see, we've seen petitions for years on people trying to change the name of Dodge City Schools because their mascot is a literal demon. It's going to take students standing up saying, I ain't going to wear a demon on my uniform anymore. I ain't going to wear a demon on my t-shirt because I serve the king who defeated all of these, and we're going to send them right back to the pit of hell where they came from. That's what it's going to take to change. But we've got to understand, y'all, there's so much noise in our lives. And so if we're going to ask God to speak, we have to give him the space so we can hear what he has to say. It's not enough to just ask God to speak. The second thing we have to do is we got to get honest. I don't know what I drank, but I'm fired up. I'm just going after all of it today. The devil's confused right now because I'm not even using my notes. We'll get there. Actually, you know what it is I don't have an ending for this service. When I preach at 9 a.m., I know I got to be done by 10 so we can make the room. I'm just saying, y'all, I might be here for 3 hours. We got to ask God. The second thing we have to do is we have to get honest. There's one thing about humans that I've learned, and it's this. We tend to oversell ourselves. We either sell ourselves short or we sell ourselves high. Most people do not have a clear, accurate picture of themselves because they believed one of two lies. They're better than what they actually are. They're more perfect than what they actually are. Or they're worthless compared to what they actually are. They're more of a failure than what they actually are. And so if we're going to identify our spiders, we've got to ask God, but we've also got to get honest. John 8:32 tells us the truth will set us free. The truth will set us free. And I was praying and I was reading and I was spending time with Holy Spirit, and I just kept hearing this word, the truth. The truth, the truth. We're fighting a supernatural war against these spiders. We're talking about spiritual warfare at this point, because we're not talking about natural spiders. We're talking about supernatural spiders. And I just kept hearing truth, truth. Well, if I want to go to war and I hear this word truth, then I think of armor, because I don't know about you, but I don't want to go to war without armor. So then I was taken to Ephesians 6, where it talks about the armor of God. This is the spiritual armor that we're going to need to go identify and kill our spiders. And I started reading through and it said, and that word truth, 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 the belt of truth. And it hit me. This is why the truth sets us free. This is why truth is so foundational. Because without it, we will never be able to use the weapons effectively to identify and kill our spider. A belt changes everything. How many of y'all have ever been pulled over? Come on. Yeah, I'm not the only sinner in the room. Praise Jesus. But I know all of us just got pulled over because our registration sticker was expired, right? We weren't doing any illegal activities. And what's that police officer do? They come up to your car and they got their hand right here. They got their hand on their... And oftentimes, nowadays, they actually have their hand on the gun, right? Because people are stupid. And so they got their hand right here. But they don't just have it on one thing, because the belt is holding what? A lot of things, right? They've got their gun. They've got their taser. They've got the handcuffs. They've got a, I don't know, pepper spray. I don't know. What do cops have? They got their walkie-talkie. They got all of their tools and all of, they got the baton thing just to beat somebody. I don't know. They got all of these weapons. They got all these tools. Could you imagine how ridiculous it would look if that police officer had to carry all of those tools into their battle without a belt? They're going to be walking up to your car, like trying to juggle everything, and then they drop the walkie and they got to pick it up, and then they drop the gun and they got to pick it up. And like, but that belt is foundational. Why? Because it allows them to use the weapons effectively when needed. And the same is true in our spiritual journey. The belt of truth. If we're not willing to get honest with ourselves, with others, and before God, we will never be able to effectively identify and then kill the spiders that we have in our life. We have to be honest. And when we have that truth, when we have the belt, when we have that foundation, it's the truth that sets us free. Free to identify and free to kill all them spiders. We've got to begin by identifying the spider. The second thing we have to do once this spider's identified, I'm just be honest, we got to go kill the freaking thing. Like, y'all find the spider, you don't just go, oh, hey, found the black widow, there she is. I'm just let her hang out. No, what do you go kill the stupid thing. We got to kill those spiders. And I want to be honest this morning, and I want you to hear my heart, because I say this in love. Therapy and counseling may be able to help you identify or even corner your spider, but you will never kill the spider with therapy, counseling, or medication. A spider can only be killed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Why? Because it is not a natural battle. I'm just saying, I've been to therapy. I've been to counseling. I've been on the meds. I get it. They're great tools sometimes. But if that's all we're relying on to find victory, then you're going to be cleaning cobwebs for the rest of your life. A spider can only be killed by the blood of Jesus Christ. And once we actually identify the spider, killing it is actually straightforward. We often think that once we find it, it's like, oh no, now what do we do? Here's what you do. The first thing is this: you confess. You confess the lie. Because remember, a spider is an agreement you've made with a lie. So in order to kill it, you confess that lie. You can say, I've believed this lie for far too long. I've believed the lie that I wasn't good enough. I believed the lie that I find affirmation in others because I never received that affirmation when I was younger, and I didn't realize everything Jesus did for me on the cross. I believe the lie that my value is found in my relationship or my partner, and I never realized that I found my value in Jesus Christ. You begin to confess this lie, and the enemy will just come in again. And he'll use guilt and shame to try and keep you silent. But I want to encourage the church this morning that if you are in Jesus Christ this morning, Romans 8:1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Yeah, come on, somebody believes it. Thank you, Jesus. Because now I can confess this lie. I can bring it to the surface. I can expose the spider. And now that it's there, what do? I reject it. And we reject the lie by the power of the blood of Jesus. And now we begin to reject this lie. We stop speaking this lie. We stop believing this lie over our lives. And we start rejecting it. And y'all, I'm not talking about the power of positive speaking when I say this. But some of us actually need to get up every single day. And we need to verbally, out loud declare, I reject this lie in the name of Jesus. Whatever lies they are. And this isn't some Oprah Winfrey 5 steps to freedom over spiders. No, no, no. We're going to reject the lie by the blood and the name of Jesus. But we've got to confess, we've got to reject, and then the last thing we got to do, because when we reject a lie, we've now created some empty space. And something about empty spaces is they were created to be filled. And if we don't do this last step, what will happen is we'll spend all this time rejecting the lie, rejecting the lie, rejecting the lie, and then one day we're going to wake up and the lie's back. Because we never actually filled the space we created. So we've got to reject the lie. And the last thing we have to do is we have to replace the lie with the truth of God's word. And guess what, church? Here's what that's going to take. You're going to have to go read your Bible. I'm just be honest. You're going to have to go read your Bible. I don't remember the Barna survey, but they put a survey out not that long ago about how many people who profess to be Christians actually read their Bible, and I don't even want to say the numbers because they were very, 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 very heartbreaking. It was like 3% of the people said they read their Bible every day. 5% read their Bible once a week. 27% open their Bible more than once a year. And these are people who confess to be followers of Jesus. How are we ever going to overcome the lies that the enemy is speaking at us if we are not getting in the truth of God's word? Because here's the reality. Every single daggum time you pick up your phone, you're being lied to. Every single time you go to work, you're being lied to. Every single time you get on social media, you're being lied to. Every single time you turn on Fox, CNN, or whatever news, you're being lied to. And if we're receiving those lies that often, just think about how much more time we need to be filling ourselves with the truth that is found in the Word of God. Because we reject the lie. I'll be honest. How many of y'all have ever been to AA meetings? This is not to call anyone out. I just want to be honest. I love that. I've been there. But one thing that I never liked about my meetings was when I went in, I had to like identify myself and state my name and then say, I'm an alcohol addict. One thing I never liked about that is I was trying to get sober, so why was I still identifying with my past? And some of us, we've got to understand that when we become followers of Jesus, the Bible says we're a new creation. So I want to tell you this morning, you're not an addict. You're forgiven. You're not too broken. You are loved. You're not a mess up or a screw up. You are a son or daughter of the Most High King. We've got to begin to confess, reject, and replace those lies with the truth of God's word. We've all got spiders. We've all got cobwebs. But here's the good news. If you're a follower of Jesus in the room this morning, we all have the same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead. And my Bible says Jesus looked at them intently and he said, humanly speaking, this is impossible. But with God, everything is possible. I don't care how big those spiders are. I don't care how many spiders you have. I don't care how much damage your spiders have done up until this point in your life because you have not yet killed them. There is nothing impossible with God. Redemption is possible. Forgiveness is possible. Restoration is possible. We've got to identify the spider. We've got to kill the spider. But then the question comes up, now what? What do I do? Well, here's the last thing, church. We've got to live in freedom. We've got to live in that freedom. I know there's some outcome-driven people in here, and you're like, okay, I get it. I follow these things, and then I kill the spider. Pastor, how do I know it's actually dead? How do I know I've not just identified it, but how do I know it's killed? Like, it's done. It's gone. I'm never going to see it again. Here's how we know if our spiders are dead. Romans 8:6. The mindset of the flesh is death, but the mindset of the spirit is life and peace. Life and peace. I've actually heard people quote this scripture, and they're like, well, the mindset of the flesh is death, and the mindset of the spirit is life. Isn't there more? Why do we end at life? Like, there's more than that, because it's not just life, but it's also peace. Can I tell you what kind of peaceful life you live when there's not spiders? You ain't worrying about nothing. You ain't stressing about nothing. And some of y'all say, oh, that's just for those crazy faith people. No, that's for everyone who calls themselves a follower of Jesus. Not just life, but peace. Jesus also goes on to say that I have come to give you life. And I've heard people stop there. What? Jesus came to give me life. I love it. But don't leave out the next piece of that scripture. Because he doesn't just come to give us life. What does he come to do? To give us life more abundantly. Oh, Pastor, I ain't trying to be like one of those prosperity people. You know what I'm saying? I like the abundant part. No. That's what we're called to be. That's how we're called to live as a follower of Jesus. It's not just with life, but with peace and in abundance. With peace and in abundance. Those spiders are sent from the enemy to do three things: to steal, kill, and destroy. And our God came to give us life and peace and life more abundantly. I'm going to be honest, church. Christians, followers of Jesus, we should be the most hope-filled, the most joy-filled, the most passionate, the most kind, caring, loving people that walk this earth. But too many of us are trying to get through life, and we're busy cleaning cobwebs, and we've got a lot of spiders alive in our life that we have to kill before we can actually live in that freedom, before we can actually live in what he's called us to live in. He has an abundant life plan for you. He wants you to live in abundance. He wants your health to be in abundance. He wants those accounts to be in abundance. And this is not prosperity, but nowhere in my Bible does it call it a poverty gospel. We're called to live in the fullness of life. And that comes when we identify the spider, when we kill the spider, and when we choose to live in freedom. Here's how we live in freedom as the church today. We look forward to heaven, but we don't wait, and we bring heaven to earth today. It is our job, it is our call as God's children to bring heaven to earth today. But if we're depressed, if we're strung out, if we're anxious, if we're worried, if we're constantly trying to live up to an image because we've got these spiders, we will never be able to be on the mission that God has called us to be on as his church. We are the hope of the world. Not because we can do it on our own. Not because you're perfect. But because the power of Jesus is alive in you. And you've experienced a hope that surpasses all understanding. You've experienced peace in the middle of a storm. You've experienced healing even when the diagnosis said there was nothing we can do. You experienced miracles and blessings even when the world wanted to count you out and discredit you. And now you go carry that good news. You go carry that freedom, and you live in it, and you invite the rest of the world to partake with you. Here's the last thing I want to say, and then I want to pray to close us out this morning. Jesus didn't die on the cross so you could just cope. He died on the cross to give you the hope that a life of freedom is possible in him. When Jesus died on that cross, y'all, I'm gonna be honest, I've had some loss in my life. But he didn't die on that cross just so I could cope with my loss. He didn't die on that cross just so I could cope with my addiction. He didn't die on that cross just so I could cope with depression or anxiety and just barely get through life as it is. He died on that cross to give me the hope to know that I have the ability to walk in the fullness of life and the freedom in Jesus Christ. All of death, all of hell, all of the grave has been overcome. And we as the church, if we're going to be a powerful church, we need to rise up. We need to go kill some spiders, and we need to live in freedom. Let's pray this morning. Father God, we thank you. Jesus, we love you in this house. God, we thank you for your word, and Holy Spirit, we thank you for speaking this word in so many different directions so all of us could understand and hear it this morning. God, I thank you that lives are being touched this morning through your word. God, I thank you for everyone in this room, those joining us online. It is not an accident that they are where they are right now. But you ordained these very steps. God, you reminded us today of the enemy's scheme, and we go to battle. And we declare right now that we are in a room full of spider killers who are going to actively seek to identify and kill the very lies that the enemy's been speaking over their life. And God, we pray right now over anyone in this room that does not yet know you, Jesus, as Lord of their life. That conviction would stir in their heart as they begin to identify a lie that they believe, that they were created just out of something and they're just on this earth existing and there's nothing more to life than this. But that lie would be dismantled this morning and they would be reminded as your Holy Spirit flows in their heart that they've never been more loved than they are right now because the Heavenly Father loves them so much that he sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for them. And that no matter what they've done, where they've gone, what's happened to them, that you still love them and that you always will. And that Jesus, because of your sacrifice on the cross, we have an opportunity, as you say in your word, to believe in our heart and confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, that we would experience salvation. Not just giving us the hope for heaven, but giving us an opportunity to be in relationship with you today, bringing heaven to earth. So if you're in this room this morning, you're listening online, and you need to confess the lie that you thought you could get through this life on your own, that you need to reject that lie and you need to replace it with God's truth this morning, that you were created by God for God, and he will be Lord of your life. I want to ask you to pray to your Heavenly Father right now. There's no special set of words you have to say, but a heart of repentance is what's needed. To repent of your sin, to ask for his forgiveness, to submit your life to him, and to surrender your will to the will of the one who created you. To declare today that Jesus is Lord of your life for all of your life. And Father, I pray over this church. God, I ask you, I pray boldly that you would begin to reveal to each of us what our spiders are. God, I pray for the silence, that we would have the space to hear what it is that you're saying. God, I speak against guilt. I speak against shame. Would you open our eyes, Holy Spirit, to see the truth? Would you reveal the lie before us? And would you take us to the truth in your word? So as we confess and as we reject that lie, we would be able to fill it with what you've said about us. Jesus, I thank you for freedom in this room. God, I thank you for freedom throughout this week. That you are equipping and building this church, that the gates of hell will not prevail against it. We celebrate you. We honor you, Holy Spirit, in this place. It's in your precious and holy name, all of God's children said. Come on, church. Amen. Amen and amen. Why don't you guys stand to your feet? We're going to end with our declaration this morning. And then just a few housekeeping things. It's going to take a little bit to get used to this rhythm, but if you've got kids downstairs, we're going to ask at the end of service that if you want to fellowship, if you want to talk to some friends or whatever without the kiddos nagging on you and pulling on you, hang out, talk for a few minutes, and then go downstairs and actually get your kids out. We're going to stop just sending them upstairs in this big rush. We're going to let the parents go downstairs, check their kids out. Don't ask me the question, hey, can I come back on Friday and check them out? No, that's not how that works. Although I like some of them more than you, just going to be honest. No, just kidding. Go downstairs, check your kids out. So if you're wondering why they're not up here running around, go downstairs and get them. If not, my kids team will, they'll eventually get annoyed and they'll call me and be like, hey, can you send this person down to get their kid? We don't want that. All right, let's end with our declaration as loud as we can. God, we love you.
God, we love you.
Jesus, we thank you.
Holy Spirit, we invite you
to help us go be the church. Service is over. Church is not. We'll see you guys next week.